and gentlemen, welcome to another one of our fantastic municipal band concerts. My name is Dusty Molino. It's my pleasure to be the conductor tonight, and we have a fantastic program for you. And as usual, we are going to honor our country, so would you please stand and rise, and we're going to play the national anthem, and we have American Legion Post number 3 here tonight with us as well. So please prepare for the colors.
Thank you.
Yeah, that was one of our old-time favorites in the band, 650 East by Jack Hale. That was written for Christian Brothers University in Memphis, Tennessee. That was their address, 650 East Parkway. And they were one of the oldest colleges in the country to have a band program. And actually, there's another march that Jack Hale wrote called 5900 Walnut Grove, and he wrote that for Christian Brothers High School, which actually has the oldest active high school band in the country right now. So if you ever need a march written for your address, I know the composer for you, and we can get that taken care of. We're going to move on now and do something a little bit different. This is a lovely little piece called Green Willow Portrait, written by Mark Williams. Mark was trying to find a way to bring all this rich band tradition of the 1920s and 30s from Ralph Vaughan Williams and a little bit of Gustav Holst and some of those classic ones that were what were prepared there. But he wanted to make it easy enough for kids to do in middle school and young high school bands. And he wrote this beautiful piece called Green Willow Portrait. Hope you enjoy. Isn't that a nice little tune? Yeah. It's one of my favorites to do with young bands, especially. Next, we've got a movie theme. This comes from the 1986 film The Mission, which was... how many of you have seen the movie The Mission? Yeah, not enough of you, but it was a very controversial film and a kind of heartbreaking film that came out in the 80s. And this was all about South of America and what happened after the Spanish and Portuguese treaty that happened in the 1700s, 1800s, and what they were going to do with the territory that they were seceding to. I think Spain was giving Portugal some territory in South Africa, and what to do with the Catholic Church that was there, and how to deal with the Native Indian problem that they were having, because they had all these people that they had to figure out what to do with. I don't want to ruin the movie for you, but I do recommend you watch it. It's some very interesting historical fiction. But Gabriel's Oboe had a fantastic soundtrack by Ennio Morricone, who was probably my favorite film composer around out there. He did all the spaghetti western stuff that Clint Eastwood did, and he did some fantastic things after that. And Quentin Tarantino used him in his Hateful Eight movie to kind of bring back that theme. I just love Ennio, and we lost Ennio a couple years ago right after the COVID epidemic hit. And I did a deep dive into his music, and I got to listen to some of this stuff again. And now there's a great band arrangement of this wonderful tune. So we're going to bring out our principal trumpet player, Mr. John Gemberling. And he's not playing the oboe, which is probably good for all of us. We don't want that. But he's got the he's got a little mute going on here, and it's going to be beautiful. A little gut bucket. Gabriel's oboe, maybe, huh? So enjoy. This is a beautiful little tune.
Thank you.
Let's have one more round of applause for Mr. Gamberling. Ennio Morricone, he can write a melody. He's a good guy. Well, next we have another one of our chestnuts for you. This is the Glenn Osser Bolero for band. We play a lot of Glenn Osser's. Bud loves to do his stuff, and the band has gotten really good at playing his things. But this is one we probably only play every 3 or 4 years, and so it's nice to dig this one up. A bolero is an old Spanish dance and kind of came out of the Fandango tradition and then sort of turned into the modern flamenco dance that everybody's sort of familiar with now. And this sort of caught the ear and the rage of Europe in the late 1800s, early 1900s, and all the classical composers were writing boleros. The one that everybody knows is Maurice Ravel's bolero, which he wrote as sort of a test piece to see if he could make that melody work all through the instruments and give everybody a chance of playing the same melody and making the snare drummers go completely bonkers by playing the same thing over and over again for about 13, 14 minutes. This one isn't that boring. It's a lovely little tune. At least for the snare drums, it's not that boring. So we hope you enjoy this band version of Bolero for Band. Did I mention it's for band? Thank you. Yeah, Glenn Osser had a very interesting life. In his young days, he played in jazz bands in New York City and got to know Paul Whiteman with the Whiteman Band. And those of you that are caught up sort of jazz history buffs, Paul Whiteman and George Gershwin got together and did this little thing called Rhapsody in Blue. Maybe you've heard about that. It might be important. And then Whiteman ended up working for NBC in the radio business, and he brought Osser along to help him out with a lot of scoring and arranging and things like that. So Osser had a fantastic career. He did all sorts of stuff in radio and TV, early TV, and did some Miss America stuff towards the end of his career as well. So very accomplished musician. We're just lucky that he wrote some stuff for band.
I got one more in.
All right, what are we doing next? Orphan Kelly. All right, well, this one is completely different. This is just a completely eclectic program tonight. It's just fun stuff. This is another one that I always like to do with young bands when I was in the classroom back at Great Falls High, which has now been about 13 years ago. I can't believe it's been that long. But Frank Tekeli is a very famous composer in the band world, and when he kind of came out in the late 80s and 90s and everybody was really starting to listen to his music and buy it, this was probably his first big hit for young bands. And then he went on to write some incredible stuff for high school and even advanced college tunes. But this is Portrait of a Clown, and sort of with the old story of if you're going to go into comedy, you have to have a tortured soul. So this clown is all happy-go-lucky on the outside, but when we get into the middle, he's a little bit sad. But he turns it around, puts his red button nose back on, and he becomes happy at the end. So enjoy Portrait of a Clown. All right, well, we've seen clowns, we've seen oboes, we know addresses, and we like green willows, evidently. So take that, algorithms. Try to figure that one out. Next, We were supposed to have a concert last week, and it got bumped because of Shakespeare in the Park, and there was a scheduling snafu with the City Parks Department. So we graciously gave up our spot and let them come in and use that. I was planning on doing this one last week, which would have been very appropriate, but now it's a little bit late. But we're still going to do it because it's a great tune. So this is John Williams' 1988 music for the Olympics, and this is the Olympic spirit. So in 84, the Olympics were hosted where? Los Angeles, yes. I would have been in middle school or junior high back then, and I just remember how much power and pride we had as a nation with those Olympics. And when I got to hear that as a young trumpet player, when I got to hear that Olympic fanfare and theme that John Williams wrote for the NBC production, it was like, oh man, that's pretty cool stuff. Well, everybody loved the stuff from the 84 Olympics, and so NBC got the rights to do the Seoul Olympics in Korea, and so they asked John Williams to write another Olympic theme, and he's like, well, if you give me enough money, I will. And they did, so here it is. The score says it takes approximately 4 minutes to play. So you could probably, if you were fast enough, you could run a mile while that song was being played. If you were an Olympic athlete, I would need like Beethoven's Ninth, the whole thing, to run a mile. So, we got lots of things to say here at the break. Let me grab my script. Well, of course, these concerts wouldn't be possible without generous sponsorship, and so I would like to acknowledge our sponsors. We have a few more this week, so this is awesome. So would you please give a round of applause for these folks as I read them off? Marianne and Dennis Granley. Thomas Railsback. Terry and Robin Simonich. And Dr. Donna Zook. Thank you so much to our sponsors. We remind you again that Zoot is right here. He's the sousaphone there, and right by the man in red. And so he loves things that go papery in there, but we will accept your small change as well. But all of your donations go to help us find new music to bring back to you and to have more fun next season. So please, if you like what you hear tonight, drop a couple bucks in the sousaphone there, and we would love that. We have one last week, and I want you all to make sure that you bring back a couple of friends with you so that we just pack this park next week. We've got one final concert, and then that will be it for the Municipal Band. So please come back. It's going to be a lot of favorites, and it'll be a good time. So 7 o'clock, we'll have one more of these. We do have a special guest tonight. It's kind of funny that he's sitting by the sousaphone, but some of you might recognize this gentleman from a while ago, but it's kind of creepy to be up here on the stage doing this because we have Colonel Tim Holton and his wife Lori in the audience. Colonel Tim retired from the U.S. Army Band. It's like Army God Band type of thing. So Tim and Lori, welcome back to Great Falls. Yeah. They taught at Great Falls High and then went on to the military life. So Tim was the band director there, and Lori was also involved in the music department. So it's great to have you back, and thanks for stopping in and hearing a concert. All right. Did I forget anything? We're good? We're good? Okay. Just trying to make sure the trumpets weren't there. All right. Well, I think we're going to go on to the next half of our concert then. So a few weeks ago, Mr. Meppam was here, and he did some scenes from Aladdin as one of his selections. And he mentioned that he thought the golden age of Disney musicals were the 90s musicals. And I will agree with him that there was some great music written, but I don't know if it was the golden age. And so I went way back in the library, and I found this. This is the Walt Disney Overture, which was actually sort of written after Walt Disney had died in the 60s. But they went back, and Frank Erickson, who's a well-known band composer and arranger, put together movie music from the first two Disney full-length movies. So this is some music from Snow White and Pinocchio. And you're going to recognize some really cool stuff here, and it's going to be fun. What we didn't realize when Snow White came out is that it was going to be the first soundtrack. After the movie was sort of released, they came up with the record, and they put that out for people to buy, and it was very popular. They didn't really have a name for it, but when Pinocchio came out a year later in 1940, that's when they first called it the official soundtrack, and that's the first time in our vernacular that the term soundtrack was used in recorded industry. So Snow White set the bar pretty high, and Pinocchio came right in behind it, and it's got some great tunes. So enjoy this little medley from Snow White and Pinocchio.
Thank you.
Aren't they good? They're good. Yeah, they're pretty good. And literally, no one in this band had seen that song until last night at about 7:40 p.m. So, they're pretty good. So, what songs did you recognize? Whistle While You Work, okay. Winner, Winner, Chicken Dinner. What else? When You Wish Upon a Star. That's Pinocchio. This one's Whistle with Snow White. Someday My Prince Will Come. And which one was that from? That was Snow White, yeah. You don't want the prince in Pinocchio, that would be weird. What's the last one? Hi Diddle Dee Dee. Yes, when Pinocchio joins the crew, yeah. Yeah, that's a fun little arrangement there. So hopefully that took you back to memory lane. I remember being a little kid and hearing the Snow White soundtrack because we had the Disney play-along records, and her voice just freaked me out as a little kid. I was like, wow, I didn't know you could sing that way. And then I found out later that she was very highly operatically trained, and so when you listen back to it now, it's still kind of creepy, but it's good creepy. Yeah. Well, next is Gently Blows the Summer Wind, and I really don't have to do any explanation on this one. Just sit back, relax, and enjoy this tune, because it's all about tonight. Thank you. And there's nothing better to do on a gentle summer breeze type of evening than to get in your horse and buggy and take a ride. So that's what we're going to do right now. This is the old Leroy Anderson standard horse and buggy. Been around for a long time. So yeah, just kind of pretend you're out there for a nice clip-clop down the road. Enjoy. You've been a great audience, and I hope you've enjoyed your little buggy ride there, which that horse and buggy leads us to Black Horse Troop, which is the Sousa March that we'll be playing to sort of end our program. Sousa loved riding and riding for horses, and he actually just loved being around horses a lot, and it weren't a lot of regimental marches where the horses were still part of the military at that point. So Black Horse Troop is one of those examples. And so he was actually envisioning troops on horseback coming out and joining the band and being part of this sort of a celebration. This is my favorite Sousa march of all time, and I hope you enjoy it. The Black Horse Troop by John Philip Sousa. Thank you. it's your turn to stand now. It's time for Montana. If you don't know the words, figure it out. It's on the back of your program, too.